This is a copyrighted work. Unauthorized copying or distribution is a crime punishable by up to 5 years in prison and a fine of $250,000.
Scholastic Audio presents Animorphs, Book 53, The Answer, by K.A. Applegate. Read by MacLeod Andrews. Chapter 1.
They're going after the elementary school,
Tobias said.
They're going after everything, I answered.
Why are they doing this? It makes no sense,
Tobias said.
It's not just brutal, it's stupid. Pointless destruction.
The nearest bug fighter swooped low and slow. It fired its Dracon beams, and the two-story gym exploded into charred stucco and twisted steel beams. It drifted almost casually above the tired old low-slung classrooms and fired again, dragging the beam end-to-end along the buildings. They're sending a message, I said. Mess with us, and this is what we do. We had destroyed the Yeerk pool. The Yeerk pool was now the world's biggest sinkhole. It looked like a crater. It was a crater, with half the mall in ruins on one slope, jumbled bits of fast food restaurants, streetlights, ripped up concrete, cars, skinny trees, all tumbled together at the bottom. The water of the Yeerk pool, looking like molten lead, soaked up through the dirt. An Exxon sign lay half submerged in it. A couple of dozen empty 1 liter soda bottles drifted around like someone's idea of toy boats. How many Yeerks had died? Certainly thousands, maybe tens of thousands. How many Hork-Bajir? How many Taxxons? Humans? We had tried to warn people, but the devastation had been too complete. Had come too suddenly.
It's not a message, Big Jake, Marco said. The Yeerks know now that we'll do whatever we have to do. They know it's all-out war. We blew up their only on-planet food supply. We're way past sending messages.
Look, they're drawing a circle.
Marco was 100 feet higher up than me. He was an Osprey morph. I was in Falcon. Tobias was himself, a red-tailed hawk.
Marco's right, Tobias said. They're making a big circle.
More bug fighters than I'd ever seen in one place. Maybe 50 of the things. They blasted schools. They blasted businesses. They blasted homes and churches. The shock waves would reach us, echoes of destruction. Pillars of smoke rose high in the air. Fires, some blazing and roaring, others smoldering sullenly, created thermal updrafts that were bread and butter to three mismatched birds of prey. We soared easily, effortlessly. We had the best possible seats for the show. With raptor eyes, we could see every sickening detail. We could not miss a shot, could not fail to see lovingly tended gardens, prized homes, businesses, cars, burn as quickly and brightly as matchheads. The refugees, people who had been our neighbors, friends, classmates, the shocked, scared, lost refugees fled on foot, carrying what they could, running between stalled cars. Overpasses were all down, traffic lights all off, bridges were collapsed. Nothing with four wheels was moving. A news helicopter was perhaps 5 miles off, no doubt filming and sending the pictures out live. The Yeerks could easily shoot down the copter. They were letting it film, maybe even piloting the craft themselves. They wanted the world to see the violence. They wanted humans to be afraid. The infiltration phase of the war was over. From now on, the Yeerks would be as subtle as sledgehammers. I caught a rush of warm air, the thermal energy released by a burning supermarket, and I soared higher, up and up. I could see what Marco and Tobias had understood. The Yeerks were creating a circle of annihilation. The collapsed Yeerk pool was the center. They were burning, blackening everything in a radius of 2 miles. That would be virtually all of what had been our hometown. And I had done it. I had given the order to destroy the Yeerk pool. All of this was a result. But why? That was what bothered me. This wasn't the time for moaning over the destruction or even for second-guessing myself. I was done with that. Why? Why were the Yeerks doing this?
Maybe they think we're down there, Tobias suggested.
I noticed something in the far distance, south of where we were. More smoke. And with my falcon's eyes, I could just barely make out hints of still more bug fighters. They looked like a cloud of gnats.
Tobias yelled, "Hey, jets!"
I followed the direction of his gaze, and sure enough, there they were. A flight of four F-16s. They were racing straight toward us, straight toward the bug fighters.
"It's suicide," Marco said.
We watched, helpless to do anything. We had spent the morning watching helplessly. The F-16s came straight in. Two of the bug fighters broke off from torching civilian buildings and turned lazily to meet the attack. Missiles flew from the F-16s and the jets broke away. Two Dracon beams fired and the missiles were destroyed in mid-flight. The bug fighters accelerated, easily caught the jets, and fired again. Three of the four exploded. There were no parachutes, no possibility of parachutes. The fourth jet rocketed low, leveled off, seeming inches from the scorched ground, and hit afterburners. The bug fighters let him go. They had nothing to fear. No, that wasn't quite true. The Yeerks were scared, just not of jets. This circle of destruction was evidence of fear. They were creating a barrier of sorts, not a wall, but a desert of ash and cinder, so that an enemy wouldn't be able to get close, unseen. It gave me a grim satisfaction. The Yeerks were scared of us. But what were they protecting? The ruins of the Yeerk pool?
"The helicopter!"
Marco yelled. The Yeerks had decided that showtime was over. They torched the news copter. A twirling cinder fell to earth. "Something's going to happen," I said.
"And there it is," Tobias said,
as always, more observant in the air than any of us. It was as big as a sports arena. It moved slowly, cumbersome in atmosphere. It was designed for space, not, like the bug fighters, to be comfortable in air. The pool ship looked like a fat, swollen, three-legged spider. I'd seen it before, up in orbit, high above planet Earth. The pool ship, home of the Yeerk invasion force, base of the bug fighters. It was a space-going Yeerk pool, well-defended, dangerous, but essentially a portable barracks, a giant mess hall that served up hearty doses of Kendrone arrays, the sustenance that a Yeerk must have every 3 days or die. The bug fighters rose to greet their mother, swarming around the pool ship, bristling, daring anyone to attack. The pool ship waddled down out of the sky, shouldering through the clouds, and gently, delicately, ever so tentatively, it rested its bulk on terra firma.
"The pool ship,"
Marco whispered reverently.
"The mother of all targets. I would give both of my arms to see that thing burn."
Then he laughed harshly.
"You know what this means, don't you?"
"They're getting hungry," I said. "They're getting very hungry." Chapter 2. My name is Jake. My name is Jake Berenson. The days of secrecy, of lurking in the shadows, are over. The Yeerks know my name. They know my height, weight, eye color, social security number, and favorite foods. At long last, they know the word animorph, Marco's word for us. My brother Tom is one of them, a human controller. He has been for a long time. He's been elevated to security chief for all Yeerk forces on Earth. My parents, my mom and dad, are controllers now too. Host bodies for Yeerks. They know it all now, the Yeerks do. All our names, all our deeds. I've fought them for more than 3 years. I was just 13 when I started. I'm 16 now, though that fact,
like so many facts, has been deliberately obscured in the secret accounts we've kept. I'm a 16-year-old kid named Jake Berenson, and I am the leader of the Animorphs. In the past, it's been hard for me to say that, to take on the title of leader. In the past, I've questioned myself, wondered whether I was right, wondered whether what I did was good, wondered whether I had any right to make life and death decisions. I've felt sorry for myself at times. Maybe anyone would, in my spot. But I had to put all that aside now. I had put it all aside. Not because I was suddenly convinced that I deserved the power, was worthy of it. That wasn't it. I knew better than to get too caught up in the myth of Mighty Jake, the Yeerk killer. I had given up soul-searching because I realized now that it was simply too late. Way past too late. The battle had become a war. And I was, for better or worse, the only leader we had. From here on out, the second-guessing, the legitimate doubts, and the self-indulgent whining, they were over. Save them for my old age in the unlikely event that I ever had an old age. We were all still alive, Cassie, Marco, Rachel, Tobias, and me. We'd been formed into a group by accident, a chance encounter in an abandoned construction site with a dying Andalite prince named Elfangor. He had given the five of us the Andalite power to morph, to become any animal we could touch. Later, Elfangor's brother, Axe, had joined us. We were just kids, but in some ways we were the ideal guerrilla fighters. The morphing power let us fly and dig and crawl, sense, hide, and fight with far more than human power. Our youth made us the least likely of suspects. The Yeerks had carried on a subversive war of infiltration for more than a decade. They had first discovered our planet back at the time of the Gulf War. For various reasons, their then Visser One had fashioned a plan to slowly infiltrate human society, infest hundreds, then thousands, eventually millions of humans with the Yeerk parasite, and when it was too late to stop them, seize sudden control of the planet. Only then would the Yeerks finalize an almost bloodless conquest. But that Visser moved on and was replaced in command of Earth by the evil creature we had long known as Visser III. Visser III was a less subtle enemy, less adept at subversion, a brute. We had fought him, lost, won, but above all survived. And in surviving, we had slowed his conquest, frustrated his plans, driven him to ever wilder schemes. We had forced his hand in the end, I guess. Now, the war of subversion was over. Visser III was promoted to Visser I, and all his most brutal instincts were unleashed. In this new, open war, we had scored some impressive victories. We had destroyed the Yeerk pool, and we helped to motivate at least partial and spotty efforts by the military to respond to the Yeerk threat. Marco's mom was free of her Yeerk slave master, free of the violent, dangerous creature who had been the very Yeerk who launched the invasion of Earth, Visser One. That Visser One was dead, and his human host now worked with us. We had used the morphing cube to make new animorphs, to increase our numbers. But we had taken hits too. We had all been driven from our homes. We had lost all vestiges of a normal life. We now hid with the free Hork-Bajir in a valley deep in the mountains, and we had lost the morphing cube. The Yeerks had it. My brother Tom had taken it, and when I might have stopped him, Cassie had let him and it go. With that act, Cassie had surrendered our edge, our one great advantage, that we alone had the power to morph. The Andalite technology was now in Yeerk hands, and we had already seen that Yeerks were using it just as we had used it, to capture all the amazing powers to be found in the animal kingdom. The six of us, Marco, Rachel, Tobias, Axe, Cassie, and I, had stayed together through impossibly bad times. Through every defeat, every close call, every mind-twisting weirdness, every horror. None of us had ever turned against the others. there had never been a betrayal. Cassie let Tom take the morphing cube. Perhaps she had done so because to her the alternative was worse. She feared for me, for my soul, I guess, if I was forced to kill my own brother. Not good enough. Not for me. All that counted now was that we win, and Cassie, maybe for the most decent of motives, had hurt us badly. I loved Cassie, always had, still did. But there was this thing between us now, and I could never trust her again. She had put my personal well-being ahead of winning a war.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.